Well, good evening, everyone. Nice to see you this evening. Sorry it's so warm in here. We do have a problem, which means that I might preach shorter this evening. I don't want to make any promises that I can't keep. I hope you had a good afternoon. I was on my own this afternoon, so I just went home from church. I grilled myself a steak. I sat down and enjoyed it. I read over my sermon notes for this evening. I took the dog for a walk. I came back and had 20 minutes nap or prayer and read the sermon again and then drove in. So it was a good Sunday. I don't know why I'm telling you that except that Gavin told me to. I want to read from Psalm. Oh, before I do that, tonight we've got the SMI gang here roughly scattered around here. Anybody that looks like a hoodlum, that's probably them. Do take the opportunity to say hello to them. And I do have something else that I have to do. I have to read something. And it is somewhere in my thing. Do you have a copy? How many of you guys? Oh, there it is. It's here. It's right here. We are going to have a meeting of the congregation. This is an official one, so I've got to read it all. A meeting of the congregation of 10th Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia is called for the purpose of voting to accept the resignation of Dr. Jerry McFarland as associate minister. The meeting will take place in the sanctuary at 12:30 p.m. on July the 8th, 2018. So now I can read from Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. O Lord God, we come to you this evening and we pray that as we gather together to praise you, to worship, and to hear you speak to us through your word, that you, Lord, would establish us, that you would give us help, that you would come to us from your heavenly hill. You would meet us at the point of our need and sustain us by your grace, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
to remain standing, and let's together confess our sins to our great God using the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. Father in heaven, who sent your Son to redeem the world and will send him again to be our judge, give us grace to imitate him in the humility and purity of his first coming, that when he comes again, we will be ready to greet him with joyful love and firm faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear now the gospel's assurance of pardon from Matthew 11. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Join me in prayer as we prepare our hearts to hear God's word. Gracious Father above, we know that you have created all things, that you spoke them into existence by the power of your word, that you are now maintaining and ruling and guiding all things by your sovereign will, and for your church by your sovereign grace. And we pray that we would be recipients of that grace this evening. And we know that in your word you tell us that this is the one to whom you will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at your word. And gracious Father, now as we do hear your word read and then preached, and as we sing and pray your word, we ask that you would make us humble and contrite and tremble with reverent, joyful fear at the thought of hearing from the creator of the universe speak to us this very night. Prepare our hearts for this very thing, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, do turn with me to Galatians, page 974. In your pew Bible, as I read from Galatians 3, 27 through chapter 4, 7, page 974. Galatians 3, 27 through 4, 7. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. But he is under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for that story, for the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ and his love, your love for us, that we sinners, alienated and set apart from you because of our sin, have now been brought near, united in Christ in your gracious love because of the work of Christ and his obedience on the cross. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for your rich provision in all things to us. And as we bring our tithes and offerings before you in honor and in thanks, would you use these for the extension of your kingdom, for the glory of your name, and the good of your church and those around. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please be seated.
So I suppose that if you've been a Christian at all for any length of time, you know almost instinctively when I say the words, the Great Commission, if I was to have a little pop quiz, I don't know how many of you would find it right away, but you know that there is in the Bible something we call the Great Commission, okay? Some of you might even be able to tell me where it is. Others of you might even be able to quote it in its entirety. I'm not going to ask you to do that, because I like to do it myself. So I'm going to do that. It's at the end of Matthew's gospel. It's the very end of Matthew's gospel. Jesus comes to his disciples and he says this, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. We call that the Great Commission. Sometimes it's called the marching orders of the church. The problem is, of course, we've just read it, and I don't know what you take away from it. Normally, if we go to a missionary meeting, then the emphasis is on the go therefore, make disciples of all nations, as it should be. Jesus has in view all nations. He has in view going, certainly to the initial disciples to whom he's speaking, and by extension to us. And we perhaps would go beyond that and say, well, if we make disciples, we're to baptize them and teach them to observe all that I've commanded you. I've read so many books of the Great Commission that there is one glaring omission from anything that they write about the Great Commission. Can you guess what it might be? Do you see that Jesus is assuming something here? He's inserting it into the very heart and nature of the Great Commission. Do you know what it is? I'll help you in a moment. I'm just torturing you for a second. Do you see? Do you understand that there are all of these elements? I mean, my favorite bit is the very end. Behold, I am with you always to the very end of the age. He was always with us till the end of the age. So we're very clear about the go therefore make disciples, very clear about the baptizing them, very clear about the teaching them to observe all the things that Jesus commanded, and very clear about the fact that where we go, he'll be with us to the end of the age. What's missing? What's missing is that in this Great Commission, Jesus refers to the name, singular, the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Apparently, the Great Commission of the church is to make known God as Trinity. Because you can't baptize people into the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. They've never heard about the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That it is the Great Commission of the church, really, to bring men and women, boys and girls, into fellowship with God, the Trinity, who is the only God that there is. He is the Christian God. Now, it's that this evening makes me want to talk to you, for other reasons as well, but this is the pressing one in my mind this evening, to talk to you about not our mission, but the missions of God. Because underlying behind, in back of the Great Commission to us, there is the fact that God is a missionary God. And we'll see in a moment what we mean by that. The missions of God is a very theological, it seems simple to you, but it's a very theological idea. In Christian theology, the missions of God denote the sending of the Son and the Spirit by the Father into the world, into the what we call the economy of grace, that is, into space and time and history, in order to work and act on our behalf. This Great Commission, which is the mission of the church in the world, tells us to go and make, to go into the world, to make disciples, to baptize them into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. There is something absolutely unique and unparalleled about that commission. In the Bible, we read about natural theology. In Romans chapter 1, for example, the Apostle Paul tells us that people without the Bible and without revelation have got available to them natural revelation, that God has built in to the creation that he's made, obviously. There are indications in the creation he's made that there is order and there is form, that there is substance to our universe. And in fact, the Apostle Paul argues that God's invisible attributes are made visible in the things that he's made. Yet even his eternal power and divine nature are visible in the enormity of the things that he has made, in the diversity of the things that he has made, in the beauty of the things that he has made. But I'm not here to talk about natural revelation this evening. The knowledge of God as Trinity does not come from natural revelation. The knowledge of God as Trinity can't even be found if you just have the Old Testament, or else Old Testament believers would have found it there. The knowledge of God as Trinity isn't possible until God goes on mission by divine revelation. And what the Bible teaches is that the knowledge of God as Trinity is a gift from God, a gift of love from God for the faithful. I want you to give you two examples of this. Two verses in John's Gospel that you will be very, very familiar with. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. You know those words. Or Romans chapter 5, God has poured his love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, whom he has given to us. Now, if you are listening to those two quotations, there is a repetition of some words, the word love and the word gift or given. Those two words are repeated in those two texts. God, the name God is repeated in those texts. God so loved the world. God has poured his love into our hearts. God so loved the world that he gave as a gift his only begotten Son. God has poured his love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been gifted to us, given to us by God's generous kindness and goodness towards us. So the love of God is in action. The love of God is in action in giving us gifts, love gifts, gifts of his love, the Son and the Spirit. Or think of the reading that we just had from Galatians chapter 4, where we're taught by the Apostle Paul to observe the Trinity in action in the matter of our adoption as children of God. When the time had fully come, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that they might receive adoption as sons. And because you're sons, God has sent his Spirit, the Spirit of his Son, into our hearts, saying, Abba, Father, for you're no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, then an heir through God. Now notice the language here. Here the language is again God doing something, taking the initiative. God sending his Son and then sending his Spirit to give the children of God the gift of being the children of God, to give us the gift, the faithful, the gift of being children of God. So what does that tell us? Well, it tells us that knowing God as the Trinity is not possible without two events in time. St. Augustine referred to them as the visible sending. Two events in time. The incarnation, where the Son of God took on a human nature. Pentecost, where the Holy Spirit comes down in power from heaven. Those two events. The writer to the Hebrews, when he's distinguishing the ways in which God reveals himself to us, distinguishes, on the one hand, the many ways and various times at which God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. And then he talks about this time. He talks about these last days when God has spoken a final word in one who is Son. Because when the Son comes, God himself comes. When the Spirit falls at Pentecost, God himself comes to his people. The Son comes to bring salvation. The Spirit comes to apply salvation to us. Now, why did God send the Son and the Spirit into the world? Well, he did it for two reasons. One is revelation, and the other is salvation. One is revelation. The mystery of God, the Holy Trinity, is revealed to us by the Father himself sending the Son and the Spirit. So when you go to John's Gospel, it begins like this. In the beginning was the Word. It's going to be talking about the Son of God. He says the Son of God is the Word. That is, he is the expression, the self-expression of God. John in the program prologue makes it very clear that that Jesus is God's self-expression eternally, the Word was with God, and that Jesus is God, the Word was God. But then in the prologue, John goes on to talk about Moses and Jesus and contrast Moses and Jesus. You know what we know about Moses in the Bible is that Moses is the one man in all history who got closest to God. We're told about Moses that he spoke with the Lord face to face as a man speaks to his friend. And it became the role of the prophet in Israel to be before the face of God, to hear the voice of God, and then to communicate that to everyone else. And so it was said that there has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses. He was utterly unique. And yet in Deuteronomy chapter 18, God makes a promise that there's going to become one. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like Moses. One who will have a face-to-face encounter with God. Be face-to-face with God. Now you say, well, Moses was like that, was he not? The language that's used when it tells about Moses talking face-to-face with God as a man talks to his friend seems to be more metaphorical. The way a person talks to another person, he had interpersonal relationships with God. But there was a great moment in the life of Moses where Moses wanted actually to see God. And he prays to God, oh God, show me your glory. And God says to Moses, you cannot see my face as I am and live. And you remember how God puts him in the cleft of a rock, and he passes by with his glory, and he says to Moses, you'll see my back, but my face you shall not see. Moses was a great man. Moses was the mediator of the covenant. Moses gave us the first five books of the Bible. Moses was an instrument of revelation. He taught us a lot about God that we need to know before we can understand the rest of the Bible. But in John chapter 1, the writer contrasts Moses and Jesus. He begins right at the beginning by saying, the Word, this eternal Word, was with God. The Greek word means literally face to face with God. From all eternity, face to face with God. Eternally with God. And the prologue ends in John's Gospel with these words, no one has ever seen God. It is the only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father who has made him known. So what it says about Jesus is that as the eternal Son, he has always seen the face of God, always been face to face with the Father, always been with the Father, always. And he's come into the world to make him known. And by making the Father known, what he's saying to you is this, we didn't know there was a Father and a Son until the Son came into the world. We didn't know that. There was nothing that prepared us for that. That the God of Israel is the Trinity. Nothing prepared us for this until the Son came into the world. And that the Son is eternally of the Father, from the Father, deriving his being from the Father. The Father is the principle and the source. That even the language that we use about Jesus, when we talk about his human nature, in his human nature entered into the kind of relationship and communion that the Son, as the eternal Son, always had with the Father. So that Jesus can say to people who are there with him, in a room, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And the God who sent the Son sent the Holy Spirit as well. We're told in John's Gospel the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and from the Son. We're told in the Old Testament that God is the one who pours out the Holy Spirit. In Joel chapter 2, I am the Lord your God. I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Peter quotes that on the day of Pentecost. And as he is describing this great miracle that has occurred on the day of Pentecost, Peter says, this Jesus that you crucified, God has raised him from the dead. God has exalted him to the highest place, to his right hand. And now he, having received from the Father the Holy Spirit, has poured him out on you, which you yourselves see and hear. The outpouring of the Spirit is the work of the Father and the Son. And so the work of the Son and the Father, the work of the Son and the Holy Spirit is to teach us by their action and by their presence in time and space that God is Trinity. Now you say, that's really hard to get my head around when I'm sweating it out on Sunday evening. And it is. Why shouldn't your brain sweat along with your pores? It is. But as you read Peter's sermon on the day of Pentecost, you learn that we cannot talk about God now without talking about God as Trinity. We are not Jews. After the Son and the Spirit came, we can no longer talk about God as if we were. Because the Trinity is the gospel. The missionaries who went to the Celtic and Germanic tribes of Europe saw it as their primary task when they went in those early centuries to teach the people the Trinity, to teach them that their gods were no gods, and that the God who created everything was God, the Holy Trinity. Sometimes they got it wrong. St. Patrick had all these various pictures. Once you have a picture of, or you think you've got an emblem or a sign or a way of construct that tries to teach the Trinity, once you've made it and you've talked about it, destroy it, because it doesn't tell you anything about the Trinity. There's nothing. There's nothing we can point to that tells us absolutely about the Trinity. And those tribes, those Celtic and Germanic tribes, were converted to Christianity by being converted to the Trinity. Because you cannot understand Christianity without the Trinity. It's part of the Great Commission. And so those missionaries to the dark bits of Europe dismantled the pagan ideas of God and then reassembled their thoughts in a Trinitarian direction. When Jesus was baptized, you remember? The Holy Spirit descended in the form of a dove and remained on him. The Father, with a voice, spoke, "This is my beloved Son." There you have the Trinity. You have the Holy Spirit descending as a dove. You have the Father's voice being heard by people. You have the Lord Jesus there in flesh being baptized by John. The Lord Jesus had the Holy Spirit without measure in his life. And it's because the Spirit of God is God that we ourselves have the light of revelation. It's the Spirit of Christ and the prophets who carried them along and enabled them to speak from God. When the Apostle Paul is writing in 1 Corinthians 2, he kind of demarcates what it is that differentiates the Christian mind from the non-Christian mind. And this is how he describes it. He puts it in these terms. He says this, we have not received the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given to us by God. So what makes the difference between the spirit of the age, the spirit of the world, and the Christian? It is that the Christian has received this divine gift, the Spirit of God. And what does the Spirit of God do? Well, he illumines our mind, he enlightens our mind. Here's how Paul goes on to put it like this. He talks about what he as an apostle does. We impart this in words, not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Spirit, interpreting spiritual truths to those who are spiritual. Now what he's doing in that text in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 is he distinguishes between what he calls the natural person and the spiritual person. The natural person is the way we're born, the way we come into the world. We're natural, we're earthbound, our minds are earthbound. To be spiritual means to have the Holy Spirit of God enlightening our minds. And so those words, those who are spiritual, puts the finger on the human problem. Paul has been talking about that at the early part of 1 Corinthians. When he's describing the people of the world, this is how he describes them. They are perishing, he says. They're in need of salvation. They are unwise because they've got a wisdom of this age that's doomed to pass away. What they need is a secret, hidden wisdom from God. And only the Holy Spirit gives that. Thirdly, they are natural, that is, they are bound to this material, physical reality and cannot get beyond that. And they do not therefore accept the things of the Spirit of God. They're foolishness to them, and they do not understand them because those things are only spiritually discerned. So you see, if you're going to become a Christian, you need the Holy Spirit. The people we want to reach need the Holy Spirit. They need the gift of the Holy Spirit to understand what we're talking about. They need the gift of the Holy Spirit to take away the cobwebs and to illuminate their minds and their understanding. We talk about the gift of the Son. We understand what he came into the world to do. But we need the gift of the Holy Spirit to illumine our minds and show us God as he is. So revelation is one thing, and salvation is another. The work of the Son is the work of salvation. God so loved the world that he sent his only Son. His sentness is teaching us something about his relationship with the Father. The Son has always eternally been from the Father and of the Father. So we can talk about his sentness, his offness, and his fromness. Just going to make up some words. Paul, when he's writing in Philippians 2, reminds us that Christ from all eternity existed in the condition of God. That's the way that one writer describes that word, in the condition of God. He was by very nature God. And he humbled himself and he took on human nature and became obedient to death, even the death of the cross. In other words, he came into the world to take on human nature in a human nature he might obey God. What was the big problem of humanity at the beginning? We did not obey God. What is our problem? We don't obey God. What did Jesus come to do? He came to do something in our place, on our behalf, for us as our representative, and as our substitute, he came to obey God. Not only did he come to obey God, he came to obey God to the very point of death on a cross. That is the death of the curse. He came by, and his mission was, obey on their behalf, die on their behalf. That was his mission. Accomplish salvation for them. Live a life of absolute obedience so that your credit can be credited to their account. Die the death of the penalty that they deserve, so that no longer is the penalty demanded of them. That was his mission. He came into the world to do that, that the world might be saved through him. Now, if that's the action of the Son for our salvation, if the Son came into the world in order that he might reconcile us to God, that's the language we read in our text when it says that Christ came into the world, that he might be made under the law, that he might redeem those who are under the law, that he might be under the law's condemnation and its demands in our place, keep its demands and suffer its punishment in our place to bring our redemption and our salvation. That's what the Son did. The work of the Holy Spirit is to open up us up to the mystery of the Holy Trinity. In the New Testament, the Holy Spirit is described as the Spirit of the Father, the Spirit of the Son, the Spirit of Sonship, the Spirit of Grace, the Spirit of Truth, the Spirit of Wisdom. And when God gives you the gift of love, which is the Holy Spirit causes you to belong to Jesus. He brings you to Jesus. He enables you to see something wonderful in Jesus. He makes you want to believe in Jesus because he makes you alive. He regenerates you. And he draws you to Christ. Not only that, but the Holy Spirit helps us to see the Father and the Son. And he enables us to actually experience the Father and the Son. In John's Gospel, before Jesus goes away, he's speaking to the disciples and he says to them, I know that you're upset. You know that I'm going to leave you. You don't know how that's going to leave you when I leave you. I'm going to pray the Father and that he would send a helper to be with you and to be in you. That helper is, of course, the Holy Spirit. And Jesus goes on to say this, when the helper comes, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will be in you and he will be with you. And I will come to you. And my Father and I will come to you. And we will make our home in you. The mission of the Holy Spirit is to come into the life of the believer and to bring with him Christ. And Christ brings the Father, so that the triune God indwells by the Holy Spirit every child of God. The Holy Spirit brings God into the souls of men, so that the Apostle Peter can say, the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. Paul can say, Christ dwells in you. Jesus says, and my Father will come, and we will make our home in you. That's the mission of the Holy Spirit. He came into the world. He was seen like the dove descending on Jesus. He was seen in the cloud of glory that hovered over Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. He was seen on the day of Pentecost as pillars of flame, like the pillar of flame that led Israel through the desert, many pillars of flame on the heads of each of the disciples. He was heard on the day of Pentecost as the disciples spoke languages they'd never learned, that people understood who were there from every part of the world. He was seen in the signs and the wonders that the apostles did that were the same as what Jesus did. That was the only time that the Holy Spirit was visible. He's no longer visible, just as Jesus is not visible. But the Holy Spirit brings Jesus into your life. And Jesus brings the Father into your life. It's the mission of the Holy Spirit to indwell the children of God. So when we think of the missions of God, that then colors the mission of the church. What our Jewish and Muslim neighbors need to know is the true teaching about God, the Trinity. They need to know that. They need to know, our Muslim neighbors need to know, the God they worship is not God. Once the Spirit and the Son came, there is no excuse for not believing in God, the Trinity. We need the doctrine of the Trinity to counteract Dan Brown and the books that he writes, the kind of modern Gnostics, and all the nonsense that makes good movies, but it's a load of nonsense. People are reading that stuff. They're reading the Gnostic Gospels and all that. We need the doctrine of the Trinity to counteract that false teaching. The doctrine of the Trinity is grown-up Christianity. It's for grown-ups, but it is Christianity. There's no Christianity without it. It's the mission of the church to go out and make disciples and baptize them and teach them everything Jesus commanded. They need to know about God, the name of God. And the name of God is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you'd receive our thanks for the great work of the Son and the Spirit who have entered into our world visibly, different ways, Christ in a physical body with a human body and soul, the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove and then a mighty wind, tongues of fire, and who carry on their work now secretly, quietly, internally, the Son and the Spirit indwelling with the Father, making their home in the lives of the believer. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us to grasp that. That's a hard thing to get our heads around. But it's what it means to be growing in the knowledge of God. And we pray, Lord, that as we go about now our task of living as Christian people, may the knowledge that God in his glory indwells us by the Spirit, that we're not alone. This is why we're not alone. This is why you will never leave us or forsake us. It's because you're closer than breathing, closer than a friend beside us, closer than life itself. You indwell our very being, and wherever we go this week, wherever we serve you this week, the Trinity is our companion, all around us and within us. Bring that realization home to us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen.